Good morning, everybody. Yesterday, New South Wales had 148,000 people who came forward to get vaccinated. Another huge day and a day we're deeply grateful for. It's really assisting us in getting to that 70% double dose figure sooner than we had anticipated. So that's fantastic news. We also had over 170,000 people come forward for testing. So huge numbers coming out to get the jab and also to get tested. We had 1,116 cases of community transmission in the last 24 hours to 8 p.m. And regrettably, four people lost their lives with COVID. And we extend our deepest sympathies and condolences to their families. Four females who unfortunately weren't vaccinated and who did have underlying health conditions. A woman in her 50s, one in their 60s, one in their 70s and one in their 80s. And again, we extend our deepest condolences to their loved ones. It's very pleasing to note that New South Wales is demonstrating our capacity for record vaccination rates, leading the nation. And I just want to remind everybody that September is the month when we're asking everybody to get ready. Get vaccinated if you're an individual, and if you're a business, start dusting off your COVID safety plan. Make sure that your employees are vaccinated so that we can get back to life at 70% double dose vaccination, which we anticipate will happen somewhere around the middle of October. And that's certainly the date we're working towards. Initially, it was the end of October, but because everybody's coming forward at the rates we're seeing people come forward, that could be as early as the middle of October. And when we hit the 80% double dose number, which we anticipate will be in November, New South Wales looks forward to having our citizens enjoy international travel. And also, New South Wales looks forward to stepping up and welcoming thousands of Australians home who've been waiting to come home for a long time. And as I've also said, once you hit that 70% double dose number, hotel quarantine looks very different. Quarantine looks very different. The way we manage the disease is very different. The way that we manage tracking and tracing is very different. And I'm having these conversations now with everybody so we can get used to what life is like in living with COVID. And again, I restate our position, which we stated from the outset. It is impossible to eliminate the Delta strain. New South Wales has proved very successful until this point in time in getting rid of other strains of COVID. But the Delta strain is a game changer. And every state in Australia, sooner or later, is going to have to live with Delta. And that's why I'm calling on all my colleagues, all other state premiers and first ministers, to stick to our plan, stick to the national plan, to make sure we give our citizens not only the freedoms they deserve, but also learning to live with COVID as soon as we can. I'm also very pleased to have with us today Dr. Ahmed Al-Rabay from Bankstown Hospital. He's a specialist there. And he has been working very hard to convince many of our members in the community that the vaccines are safe. Either vaccine is safe, and he'll speak about his experiences and all the great community work that's been going on to encourage all of our citizens to come forward and get vaccinated. Dr. Gao will now give the public health update. Deputy Premier will deal with rural and regional issues, and then we will take your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Premier, and good morning, everybody. Till 8 p.m. last night, there were 1,116 locally acquired cases of COVID-19 reported in New South Wales, and there were also two overseas cases. Again, the people of New South Wales came out in record numbers to be tested, and a big thank you again for people for doing so. There were 173,913 tests reported till 8 p.m. last night. In hospital at the moment, we have 917 COVID cases admitted. There are 150 people in intensive care, 66 of whom require ventilation. As we've seen to date, the majority of those people in ICU have not been vaccinated. And of those 150, 127 people in ICU are not vaccinated. As the Premier said, sadly, we report the deaths of four people today. They are a woman in her 80s from southwestern Sydney who passed away at Royal Prince Alfred Hospital. She was not vaccinated and also had some significant underlying health conditions. We also report the death of a woman in her 60s from Western Sydney who died at Concord Hospital. She was also not vaccinated and also had underlying medical conditions. A woman in her 50s passed away. She was from southwestern Sydney and died at Liverpool Hospital. She was not vaccinated and also had some significant underlying health conditions. A woman in her 70s passed away from southwest Sydney, also at Liverpool Hospital. She was not vaccinated and also had underlying health conditions. And on behalf of New South Wales Health, I extend my deepest sympathies to the families of those four ladies who have sadly passed away. Of concern today is that we have had sewage detections in quite a number of locations across New South Wales. And we do encourage residents of those areas to please come forward for testing. And those areas are in the Murrumbidgee LHD in Tamora, in southern New South Wales area of Thredbo and Murrimbula, in mid-north coast, in Port Macquarie, Dunbogan, Bonnie Hills, western New South Wales, the people of Warren and Molong, and in Hunter, New England, Tamworth and Gunnedah. So if you live in any of those areas, please come forward for testing. We're currently unaware of any COVID positive people in that area that might explain the sewage detection. So please come forward for testing. And finally, I'd just like to again call out those suburbs in the Greater Sydney area where we continue to see the highest number of cases. And again, emphasise our request to people living in those areas to please take up every opportunity for vaccination. Please follow the stay home orders like everyone else in New South Wales, and please come forward for testing. And those suburbs are Guildford, Georges Hall, Merrylands, Auburn, Punchbowl, Bankstown, Lakemba, Yagoona, and South Granville. Thank you.
Good morning, and can I start by offering my condolences again to those families that lost loved ones. You remain in our thoughts and prayers. Overnight, to 8 p.m. last night, we've had, again, a continued number of cases in regional and rural New South Wales. In the far west, three new cases in Wilcannia, which, again, leaves us with concern. And speaking of Wilcannia, we know over the past few days with the increased cases, we have had an issue around accommodation, but the ability to isolate individuals. New South Wales Health has procured 30 motorhomes, which will be set up at the local council-run campervan site, where they'll have access to power and water and, of course, waste disposal. And this has been already communicated with the community and embraced by the community, and that'll start next Monday. So an opportunity to really to put an extra effort into Wilcannia. Again, for those residents of Wilcannia, please come out and get tested. In Western New South Wales, our numbers were down from yesterday, 29 cases, predominantly all in Dubbo, 18 cases in Dubbo. Then there was three in Bourke, two in Blaney, two in Narromine, and Bathurst, Mudgee, Orange and Walgett all have had a case each. In the Hunter region, six new cases, four were in the Lake Macquarie local government area, and two from Newcastle. On the Central Coast, again, two more cases overnight. They were linked to previous cases. And Illawarra, again, eight cases overnight, six in the Wollongong local government area, one in the Shoal Harbour local government area, and one location is still under investigation. That'll be confirmed later today. Southern New South Wales, there were no cases. Can I also put a call out to the community of Wilcannia? What we've seen in the Central Darling local government area is a significant increase in vaccination. And in just under a week, an increase of about 11% across the board. That includes places like Wilcannia, where now we have 67% single dose and 39.2% double dose vaccination for that community, which is a mighty effort from where we started from. But my call out to those communities is to continue to get vaccinated. And on a further message about vaccination of the people of Broken Hill, we know there are cases, we know the proximity to Wilcannia and some hotspots. We are encouraging people not only to come out and get tested if there are early signs, but most importantly is to improve those vaccination rates. So again, a call out to regional rural New South Wales, get vaccinated. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Dr. Ahmad Arubi. I'm an associate professor at the University of New South Wales and a gastroenterologist and therapeutic endoscopist. I work at Bankstown Lidcombe Hospital, but I am here as a representative of our communities in West Sydney and South West Sydney. Our communities in Bankstown, Canterbury, Fairfield, Liverpool and Campbelltown have been hit hard by COVID-19. These areas are virtually the epicenter of this wave in New South Wales. I have been one of many community leaders, organizations, and individuals who have been working hard to keep our community safe. Our communities in these areas are responding well to the calls to get vaccinated and staying home. We have a progressive increase in the rate of vaccination, particularly over the last 6 weeks, with more than 66%. These are data from 2 days. 66% having the first dose, and more than 30% having both doses together. We have this in spite of we still have some of our people in our communities confused by the misinformation which is circulating through the social media and through their social networking. This misinformation was including every single aspect of vaccination early in the process of rollout, including the contents, the ingredients, all the myth about this content, including the short period of production. But currently, the focus of this misinformation is on the safety profile, on the side effect of the vaccination, and to a lesser extent, on their efficacy. And as a result, we still have some people hesitant about getting the vaccination. To those people, I say, COVID-19 vaccination are safe and effective. This is not only our experience here in Australia, it's the experience of the world and all developed countries. Up until 3 days ago, there were 5.2 billion doses given worldwide. And we have a lot of data from all this number about the safety of the vaccines and the very low, narrowed profile of the serious side effects of these vaccines. COVID-19 vaccines are effective and they are the best available protection against the virus. They are effective in reducing the chances of catching the virus. They are even more importantly effective in preventing the serious forms of the disease. They are effective in keeping you away from hospitals, intensive care units, and from death. By vaccination, you protect not only yourself, but your kids, your family, your friends, and your contacts. My message is also to our young men and women. Delta variant of the vaccine is much more infectious than the original version, and we see more and more of young, healthy and fit people, and even children having the disease are infected. Delta virus can cause more serious features and disease in young and healthy people. And all of us knows that the number of young people, less than 40, in the ICU are increasing. Long COVID can have a bad impact on your learning and study. And this can continue even after the full recovery from the disease. Don't listen to any social media. Don't listen to any YouTube. Don't listen to any WhatsApp networking among you guys. The only reliable source and trusted source is the information from the health authorities, from health professionals, and from sites you can get, including the nsw.gov.au. Talk to your GP. Talk to your specialist if you have any concern about the vaccine. Our communities in general are tired. and many are concerned. But we are strong, we are resilient, and we are confident that we will get through this. I think the fight against this deadly virus is the responsibility of every single person of us. It is your responsibility also. By first, get vaccinated without any delay. See your GP, see your pharmacist, and visit the nsw.gov.au for an appointment. Get tested with the minimal symptoms in our areas, because there are still hot spots. Or even without symptoms, if you think you are a contact, close contact, or a casual contact. The test is very simple. It takes a few minutes. It's free, and it's available everywhere in our areas. But it has a very important role in early detection of cases, and early diagnosis, early treatment, and in localizing cases and in tracing contacts. So please get tested. Don't visit others, and don't accept visitors in your household for their safety and for your safety. Stay home, unless for essential work. Thank you.
Doing, please expect to do all those things we've been missing for too long. You know, is that a promise, first of all? And does that apply, because a lot of people will be watching from the hotspots, does that apply across the board in New South Wales? And everything, does that mean everything? Home gatherings, cinemas, sporting events, outdoor pubs and clubs, everything.
Obviously, New South Wales always takes a responsible approach, but the national plan does say at 70% double dose vaccination that you can expect to go out and have a meal, you can expect to attend a public event, you can expect to go and get services that you can't expect to have done now. But obviously we'll take a very responsible approach, and we know what the high risk areas are. Indoor gatherings or people coming to your home are high risk. But outside of that, if there are many, many things we can't do now, we should expect to be able to do them when we have 70% of our adult population double vaccinated. That's the national plan. That's what the national plan says. I'm not saying any differently, anything that every other state hasn't signed up to. And obviously that increases once you get to 80%. Of course, at 70%, there will be density requirements in relation to venues. There'll be QR code check-ins, validation that you're vaccinated, mask wearing in certain settings. So there will be obviously constraints and some restrictions in place. But compared to what we're going through now, life will be much better at 70% double dose than what it is now. And that's why I'm really calling out to businesses to say, let's have September the month we all get ready. If you're an individual, get vaccinated, get your loved ones vaccinated. And if you're a business, dust off those COVID safety plans and get ready to reopen your doors.
You've also said,
Premier, hotspot LGAs, will people, if they're fully vaccinated, in the LGAs of concern, be able to look forward to the same freedoms that other people who are vaccinated will get at 70% double dose?
Well, clearly, we've had a concentrated effort to vaccinating our population in those local government areas of concern. And the vaccination rates not only have come up from a very low base, but now a lot of those areas have far higher vaccination rates than other parts of Sydney or New South Wales. And as we've said, the key issue for us moving forward is the rate of vaccination and how many people you can keep out of our intensive care wards and hospitals. And they're the figures that matter the most. So everybody should expect a level of freedom which they don't have today. And in relation to those settings, we're going through the roadmap, we're getting the health advice. It will also depend obviously on a number of other factors, but let me be very clear, no matter where you live in New South Wales, please expect to have much more freedom than what you do now, so long as you're vaccinated fully and so long as 70% of our residents are vaccinated. And details of that will be provided in the next little while. So,
On the hotspots, will it be equal freedoms? Will hotspots get equal freedoms to people that aren't in hotspots?
Well, look, we're obviously looking at all those issues, but I do want to say to every citizen, no matter where you live, life will be much, much better, much freer, so long as you're vaccinated at 70%. We'll provide details as soon as we can. We're obviously taking input from stakeholders, from our health experts, and also comparing it to the national plan, which has already been released. So the national plan is on the public record, and New South Wales would be adhering to that national plan. And obviously, we're really keen to see our nation move forward. But we also appreciate that what is the most critical numbers for us to keep a very close eye on is the rate of hospitalisation and the rate of vaccination, because at 70% double dose and 80% double dose, life will be very different and life will be much better than what it is today.
You've said in the past that October is going to be our most challenging month for our hospitals. There's modelling. Why can't... Lucy asked this yesterday. Why can't you disclose that modelling, the worst-case scenario, the best-case scenario, so that we as citizens can make a judgement about whether that's correct?
Well, the best judgement is what the public health experts are telling us. And every day the modelling changes. Every day there's inputs put into the modelling. And every day there's different models around. There's many, many institutes across the nation that will provide input into what New South Wales looks like. But that's depending on a number of variables. And we shouldn't be in the habit of providing information which is not certain, because it depends on the inputs. It depends on the rate of vaccination. It depends on what people are doing. It depends on compliance. There's a whole range of issues that go into that. But what we do know, because of the best test case is the accumulation of case numbers, we know that there is always a lag between when someone gets ill and when they end up in hospital. And we anticipate, given where the case numbers are and given the rate of vaccination, that the highest rate of hospitalisation will occur at some stage in October. As soon as we see anything more certain than that, of course, we'll provide that information. But
yes, to suggest cases could peak at 2,500.
Well, there's been modelling put on the public data, which has many ranges, and we've... I've seen various versions of modelling and I can't recall what all the numbers are, but I can tell you this much, that we know that the rate of hospitalisation is likely to peak sometime in October. We know there's ranges of predictions on what the case numbers will come up to. I've often said, as Dr. Chant and Dr. Gal and others have said, we anticipate the worst will be in the next couple of weeks in terms of case numbers. And that is because the worst will be in the next couple of weeks, because the impact of the vaccinations takes about 2 or 3 weeks. And as we've said from the outset, lockdowns work in suppressing the spread of the virus, but the best antidote, the best weapon in fighting the virus, is the vaccine. And once we know someone is vaccinated, it takes effect in 2 or 3 weeks' time. And we know there's been a high concentration of vaccines administered in the last week and the upcoming 2 weeks. So it follows suit that we still anticipate case numbers to rise in the next couple of weeks. And then we anticipate and hope that they will start to come down. It's Ursula's turn, yeah.
Well, I do have a question, but I will actually just let Alex finish that.
Okay, sure.
Just a follow-up there. You can't recall what the worst-case scenario peak that you've been presented with is.
Well, no, I'm saying there's various modelling that is done. New South Wales Health provides us with modelling, but there's also modelling done by external organisations, which New South Wales Health isn't part of. And those external organisations, as we've all publicly read, have varying degrees.
What's the advice to you from New South Wales Health? The worst case scenario they presented to you, you don't recall what that is.
Look, the worst case scenario varies, and it varies, and it depends on what the inputs might be. And I wish I had a crystal ball to be able to tell you. What I can tell you, the most recent advice that I have received is that case numbers are likely to continue to rise for the next few weeks, and the worst hospitalisation rate is likely to be in October. And I can't tell you any more than that, because that is the best advice that I have.
Just on those restrictions, just back. So everything is on the table at 70%. Stadiums open, you said this morning on Sunrise, so stadiums will be open, home visits are on the table, cinemas are on the table.
Well, obviously, things like, as I said, high risk issues like home visits is what the greatest risk is. And what is key is for us to be able to demonstrate that people are vaccinated. So when you have a controlled environment, like a venue or an outdoor event that's ticketed, you can actually control that only vaccinated people come through. And that is the key. The 70% freedoms relate directly to full vaccination. And that is why it is key for us to be able to demonstrate that people are fully vaccinated when they're attending an event or attending a venue. And clearly, for all of us, indoor is more high risk than outdoor. But having said that, controlled, regulated environments are safer than uncontrolled environments like homes. So it would be far safer, for example, for a family to have a meal in a restaurant than it would be necessarily to have people come into their home that may or may not be vaccinated. So the key to freedoms is the full vaccination, is someone being fully vaccinated and being able to demonstrate that. And that is what we're basing our roadmap on. And that is what we'll obviously convey to the community as soon as we finalise those plans. And I'm hoping it won't be too long before we can do that, but it will reflect very closely the national plan that the Prime Minister and all the state leaders have been discussing. So it won't diverge from the national plan, but it will be our commitment to stay true to that. Clearly, for example, in some states, they may have 2 square metre rules depending on their number of cases. In New South Wales, we might start with 4 square metre rules. So I put that on the table, that they're the type of issues that we'll consider closer to that time, and obviously with the best health advice. And similar to our plan for schools, that we obviously took the health advice, took education advice, and then made decisions. And this will be a similar approach. Stakeholders are coming forward with their suggestions, and the health advice is critical. But every state can assess its own risk. It's 70% double dose, and I'm sure some states will continue the way they are, but states like New South Wales and Victoria will need to look more closely at what the case numbers are doing at that time. And I anticipate density may be, for example, an issue which differs from state to state at 70%, but I'd much rather know that I can go to a venue and have a meal or have a drink or get a service that I can't get now than not, and that's the strong message we want to send to the community.
You seem more adamant today in your rhetoric that of the prospect of international travel when we do reach 80%. So why now have you decided to halve the international arrivals cap?
Oh, that is only a temporary issue for the next month. We know at the moment, this is the irony. For example, Dr. Gale read out today, I think, 2 overseas cases. So we have 2 overseas cases where thousands and thousands of staff are looking after 2 cases with COVID versus the number of cases we have in the community. So as a pause in the next month, we've halved our travel. Every state, most states have. I think Victoria for a long time didn't take anybody. We're still taking more than any other state, is my understanding. But having said that, once we get through September and October, which are the months we're most worried about, and once we get to 80% double dose, I want New South Wales to lead the way. If Australians come home through Sydney Airport, I welcome that. Once we get to 80% double dose and we have a different quarantine system, one that involves home quarantine, for example, for returning Australians that are fully vaccinated, one that has a different system which is less reliant on health staff and police staff, we can then put those resources elsewhere. And I would welcome Australians coming home through Sydney Airport, because once you have 80% of your adult population fully vaccinated, once you're welcoming home Aussies that are fully vaccinated, you have a different quarantine system. And that's why I'd like all of us to think about what life will look like at 70 and 80% double dose. And this is one other key, really important measure. I'm confident, without a doubt, that we'll get to 70% single dose in the next few days. So we know for a fact that 70% of our population, once you've signed up for the first dose, you're going to get the second one. So that gives me confidence we're going to hit a 70% target. But what is the greater challenge is to make sure we get first doses to 80% as soon as we can. Because once we know first doses have hit 80%, those people, those citizens have signed up for the second dose. And that gives us, there's not a lot of, I think the only 2 places on the planet are Malta and Singapore that have 80% double dose vaccination. And that's certainly a target we need to get to allow for international travel.